Thank you. You may be seated. Appreciate it. Thank you. I know that our leadership team is on their way in, and I did want to take a moment here to just thank you. Some of you, of course, you've been aware, you've seen that we've got a new look on the backside of the building. That's because some of the shrubs are gone and some of the dirt is turned up and all this. It's been an interesting process so far. We are externally, at least as far as the foundation goes, we're externally kind of there. We actually need to deal with some issues up on the roof and the gutters and things like this with our moisture issue, but the drainage and things like this. And as you see in the bulletin, I don't have the latest figures for you on how our project is going financially, because one of our treasurers, the one who oversees that side of it, has been on vacation for this week, but when he gets back, I'm sure we'll get the details. But you have been so generous, and I know that you will continue to be, that some folks have been giving, and you've been giving incrementally. Some were giving one big sum and others were giving one time and things like this, but others are giving incrementally. So we're kind of about, I think, halfway there financially, and we want to continue to encourage you and thank you for your generosity. We want to let you know that I think some of the steel is here or has been ordered and is here, whatever, for our ramp. The painting discussions are still in place, and we're actually, we hear noise around the boilers during the week. They're banging away, removing old boilers and getting ready so that we can be all prepared. You folks have done a marvelous job at just jumping into this and being sacrificial. We want to thank you for that. We're about halfway there. Lord bless each and every one of you. It is time now to move into the structure of the worship, as you will find in your bulletin.
Good morning. Let's bow our heads for prayer, please. Father in heaven, I thank you so much for the opportunity that you give us to come and worship together. I thank you for the wonderful family, wonderful church family that you've brought together. I ask you to send the Holy Spirit to enlighten our minds. Please help us to hear the words you would have us hear. In Jesus' name, amen. I'd like to welcome you all to the beautiful College Church in South Lancaster, Massachusetts. And those of you that are joining us by TV, welcome. We have a wonderful program today for you. And after the program, if you have any special prayer requests or praise, please meet with Pastor Ernan Norman in the junior room. Thank you for being here.
Good morning, church. It's time for a call to worship. Please stand. I will be reading the light print, and you will be reading the bold print. Do any come into this place with perfect praise? But is your king not worthy of perfect praise?
Yes,
Praise him.
Please be seated. And good morning. There was a farmer who was extremely creative. He taught his animals how to speak. And every day he would go out and greet the animals and have a wonderful time. He'd say good morning to the cow, and the cow would respond back and forth. Well, one day, you'll find out that he was not a Seventh-day Adventist pastor or a farmer, but that he went out to the barnyard and said, you know, this morning, I want to have bacon and eggs. Whoa. Bacon and eggs? That's right. Well, the chicken said, that's great. That's wonderful. However, they looked over at the pig, and the pig wasn't so happy. The pig wasn't so happy. And so they said, well, what's the matter, pig? What's the matter? Don't you want to make the farmer happy? Of course I do. But the chicken says, come on, pig, let's do it. Well, I've got to think about this a minute. What do you got to think about? Well, it's very simple. You see, the farmer is asking you to make a contribution, but he's looking for a commitment from me. You see, that's what it's about. Are we making a contribution, or are we making a commitment? That's the question. You see, we have young people in this congregation that need to be in a Seventh-day Adventist school. None of them should be without a Seventh-day Adventist education, because a Christian education doesn't cost, it pays. And so I would ask you to think whether you're making a contribution or are you making a commitment to what God has asked us to do. The offering is for the Southern New England Conference budget, and at this time I would ask the deacons to come and wait upon us. Thank you. We pray that you will take these tithes and offerings, contributions and commitments, to multiply and speed your coming. In Jesus' name we pray, amen. Please be seated. At this time, it's time for the children to come forward to collect the lamb's offering. And did you hear that? The lamb's offering. So children, if you'll come forward, and Pastor Hines from the Southern New England Conference of Seventh-day Adventists is going to bring you a children's story this morning.
Little lower obligato there. Well, good morning. Hi, guys. I don't know if you know Pastor Hines. This lady knows Pastor Hines. Where's your daughter? She's here somewhere. There she is over there. Okay. She knows Pastor Hines. But this is our first chance to meet him here. He's new in the conference, and he's going to be working with kids and young adults and this kind of thing a lot. And you don't know what the lamb's offering's for, do you?
No.
Okay. The lamb's offering, what we do with it is some of it goes for worthy students, and some of it goes for Camp Sunrise in the summer, and some of it goes to enhance children's ministries, Pathfinders and Adventures, and some of it goes for, we're sending a team to Kids University in Tennessee here in a few weeks, and it's going to help to fund that. So that's what the lamb's offering goes for. It's dedicated for children's ministry things. Need to ask you a couple questions, because you guys don't know him very well. You're new here.
That's right.
Okay, I'm not sure if your microphone's on. Okay, I'm not sure if you're powered up. Let's find out here. Oh, I'll push that button and we'll see if you're happy in a second.
Hello, hello, hello.
Yeah, there we go.
You can hear me.
All right. Okay, you're new here. You've only been here a few months.
Yep, came in April.
In April. Do you know where he came from? Wasn't Clinton.
No, a little bit further.
Wasn't Boston.
No, a bit further than Boston.
Where was it?
The UK.
England! He came all the way across the ocean.
Yeah.
That's right. And you've got your daughter here. Where's she?
Daughter,
she's over there.
Phoebe.
Yeah, Phoebe. Hi, Phoebe.
Paying
she's
attention
admiring
to the instruments.
The instruments over there. I think you're headed for music lessons. I'm just giving you a warning right
yes,
now.
Yes, when she's five.
Okay, okay. Is your wife with us today?
Yes, she is.
Where's she hiding? Somewhere.
Okay. She's here somewhere.
She's here somewhere. Okay.
Like Eve, she's
anyway.
Gone.
Well, we're glad you're here. And this is Pastor Robert. Say hi, Pastor Robert. Okay.
Ooh. Okay, good morning, boys and girls. Let's do that a little bit better. Just imagine you're at school or preschool, and the amount of noise I hear from the playground, I need that sort of volume, okay? Good morning, boys and girls.
Good morning.
Excellent. I like you. I like you. I want to tell you a story about oranges. How many of you like fruit? You know, you're meant to eat fruit every single day. A few portions of fruit helps you grow. Well, the oranges that I want to talk to you about aren't the oranges you get here in the United States. They're not the ones from Florida. And they're not the ones that come from Israel. These oranges come from the island of Jamaica. Now, in Jamaica, the oranges are huge. Big beast of orange. They're the size of grapefruits. And they've got this really thin skin, but they're very sweet and they're very juicy. Wonderful orange. If anybody gives you an orange from Jamaica, that's a cherished prize. Eat it and cherish it and savor every moment. Okay, so I want to tell you about oranges from Jamaica. There's this man, and he's got a wonderful job. He's a truck driver. He loves it. He loves feeling the power when he's steering this big old 18-wheeler truck around the roads. He loves it. And his particular job was to carry goods from a port to a distribution depot. That was his job. So they would load up his lorry, he would jump in the cab, and he would drive it to wherever they wanted to be taken, to a particular distribution depot. Now, our friend John had a particularly bad habit. John would steal things every now and again. First, it started off small, like a couple of pens from the office. And then it grew bigger and bigger, like a couple of files of paper, reams of paper. And then it came into stealing goods from the port itself, like jumpers that came in, or a hi-fi system that came. He would get away with it. And the more he got away with it, the more it encouraged him to do it. But it was a bad habit. Now, the port was aware that things were going missing. So they thought, we need to do something about this. And you know what they did? They got a security guard. And they put him at the entrance to the port. And they had this big old barrier that would go up and down, and the trucks would come up to it, and he would check over the truck, make sure everything was in order, that nothing was there that shouldn't be there. But John wasn't worried, because he had a secret hiding place. And his secret hiding place wasn't in his glove box. It wasn't on his bed behind him. It was underneath his chair. For some reason, the security guard never, ever looked there. So on this particular day, John was walking around the port, and he happened to see a consignment of oranges from Jamaica. Huge beast of it. Anyway, wow, look at the size of these oranges. I'm going to take some home for my wife, take some home for my boy and girl. They're going to really enjoy these oranges. So he poured out this bag, and he poured a few in, and then a few turned into half a dozen. And in the end, he managed to get 12 huge oranges into this bag. Wow. Yeah. And then he got into his truck, and he hid it. Where did he hide it? Underneath his seat. And then he drove up to the exit. Of course, the security guard was there. Down was a barrier. So he stopped at the barrier, and the security guard said, "Come down, John." John wasn't worried. He had been through this so many times before. And he got down, and the security guard climbed up. He looked in the glove box. He looked around on his bed. He looked over the cab. Everything seemed to be in order. The security guard jumped down out of the cab. As he did, the whole cab shook. The bag of oranges underneath his seat toppled over, and one large orange rolled down the cab, down one stairs, down the next step, onto the ground, and rolled directly to the security guard's feet. Security guard shook his head and said, "John, you best come with me." The security guard pulled out the bag of oranges, took the one that was on the ground, and says, "You best stay in here." And he locked John in his hut. And he says, "I'm going to get the manager." Now, John was upset, to say the least. "Oh, my days, what am I going to do? I'm going to lose my job. My wife is going to be upset with me, to say the least. My kids are going to be hungry because I want to get another job. What am I going to..." And the crazy thing about this, even when you're in a situation which you created, you can still pray. Even when you mess up, and you know you messed up, you can still pray. And John, even though he has stolen, he decided, I'm going to pray. So he prayed, Lord, help me. And if you help me this time, I'll never, you know those prayers, don't you? I'll never, ever do it again. I promise. Please. Lord, please. And then an idea came to him, because God speaks to us, okay? And an idea came to him. He said, I can only get in trouble if there's evidence. Evidence. Now, it was back in the days when you could carry a pocket knife. So he pulled out his pocket knife, and he took out the first orange. Huge thing. Peeled it. And he ate it. Oh, it was sweet. Oh, it was juicy. Oh, it was very filling as well. But then he thought, the skin. So he took the next orange. He just cut it into quarters. And he ate it with the skin and the seeds. And you know that hard green bit at the top of the orange? He ate that as well. 12 huge oranges. He was just wiping the knife and putting it away when he heard the key in the door. In walked the security guard, and in walked the manager. They could smell the oranges. They searched high and they searched low, but they never, ever found any trace of an orange. And more importantly, John never, ever stole again. Now, obviously, there's lots of lessons you can learn from this. The first thing is this. Don't steal. Don't steal. Just don't get into the habit of it. Don't let it tempt you whatsoever. Do not steal. The second thing, which is also very important, even though you mess up, even though you decide to do something wrong, you can still pray. No matter how mischievous you've been, you can still pray. And thirdly, the devil wants to trap us by helping us, encouraging us to form bad habits. And as boys and girls, we want you all to grow up having good habits so the devil never is able to trap us. So boys and girls, let's bow our heads and close our eyes as we pray. Let's pray. Our Father God, we just want to thank you for these boys and girls. They're very precious to us. And we want them to one day walk the streets of gold with you in paradise. So help us to bring these children up to know you and to love you. We pray the Lord that you'll protect them from harm and danger, seen and unseen, and that they'll be kept safe. Bless them with all that they need to know you. We pray this in Jesus' wonderful name. Amen. Thank you, boys and girls. You can go back to your seats.
us who are in front, if we could step forward just a little bit as we kneel for prayer. And many of you who may wish to come closer, as we kneel together, let us speak to our Heavenly Father. Thank you. Speak, Lord, in this moment while we wait on you. And as we approach your throne, may we hear thy voice welcoming us as your children. And we come, Lord, to thank you and to praise you because we have been spared another Sabbath to worship in your courts. We have been spared from the hands of death. We have been spared from the tragedies of life. So we have so much for which to be thankful. But above all, we thank you for your grace, your salvation in Christ Jesus, your only Son who died for our sins. And so we ask today that you would forgive us of our sins, that you would cleanse us from all unrighteousness, that our prayers be not hindered this morning, and that we will be heard clearly in the courts above. We have come, Father, to present to you our needs, our concerns, our joys, our sorrows. There are many in our prayer focus who have held concerns, and there might be others not yet on that list. We present them to you now and ask that you would minister to every need and every concern individually and collectively. According to your riches and glory, Father, touch and heal and restore and comfort those who need your comfort today. And then, Lord, we pray not only for them, but for the entire body of the worshipers here today, all the families here. We differ in our faces, so we differ in our concerns and needs. But we say, Lord, thank you for hearing us and for ministering to us. Remember our community for which we stand to minister and witness. We ask, dear Lord, that you would help us to be a light to those on the outside and those around us in our neighborhoods, that they may see Christ in us, the hope of glory, that we will bear a dynamic witness that will win souls for you. There are those who are struggling with doubt and fear. We ask, Lord, that you would help us to reach them through our collective and individual witness. And then, Lord, today we commend this service into your hand and the one who have been appointed to preach the word, even Elder Hines. We ask specifically today that you would speak through him, that he will hear your voice. We ask, dear Lord, that your word will be powerful and active, and that it will bring forth the fruits of repentance. May it afflict the comfortable and comfort the afflicted. May we, Lord, hear your voice once again, and as a result, may we be drawn closer with a deeper commitment and repentance and have a closer faith walk with you today. And so, Father, this service we commend into your hands. As we wait patiently on you, we wait expecting your blessings. As we ascend to your throne with glory and praise and thanksgiving, may you descend to us in your blessings, we pray. Bless your waiting people now. In Jesus' name we ask it. Amen.
Happy Sabbath, Church. I will be reading the Word that Lives, and I will be reading it from the New Revised Standard Version, Judges 2, verses 8 through 13. Again, Judges 2, verses 8 through 13. Joshua, son of Nun, the servant of the Lord, died at the age of 110 years. So they buried him within the bounds of his inheritance in Timnathheres, in the hill country of Ephraim, north of Mount Gaash. Moreover, that whole generation was gathered to their ancestors, and another generation grew up after them, who did not know the Lord or the work that he had done for Israel. Then the Israelites did what was evil in the sight of the Lord, and worshiped the Baals, and they abandoned the Lord, the God of their ancestors, who had brought them out of the land of Egypt. They followed other gods from among the gods of the peoples who were all around them, and bowed down to them, and they provoked the Lord to anger. They abandoned the Lord and worshiped Baal and Astartes. May the Lord add a blessing to the reading of his holy word.
As I shared with the children, it is indeed our privilege today to be welcoming a new member to the Southern New England Conference. And it's your first opportunity for many of you to meet him. Elder Robert Hines, new Associate Youth Director of the conference. I know that his transition was long in coming. Between the time that it was determined that he would be here and getting him here was two different stories. And so we're certainly grateful that you're here today and looking forward to what you have to share in the Word. I would mention that someone, I believe maybe one of the children, lost a medic alert bracelet. So I have it. If you know that someone should have a medic alert bracelet, they don't, I have it. Blessings on you, Pastor Hines. Thank you.
Good morning and happy Sabbath, everybody. I want to thank Pastor Pate for the privilege of being here and the opportunity to share a word from God with you. We serve an awesome and wonderful God, don't we? And it's a privilege to be a part of his family. And it's a privilege to be an Adventist, is it not? It is. You don't sound so convincing, but I believe that in the depth of your heart, you do believe passionately that it's a privilege to be an Adventist. It's a Sabbath day, and we come because we want to hear something from God. We want to be blessed by him to hear the voice of God speaking into our own situation, into our own lives, so that when we come away from here, we know that God's voice, God's inaudible voice, has been heard. So to that end, let us pray at this moment. Our Father God, we come before you with our empty and broken lives. We come before you even though we are sinners. We come before you even though we are wretched, because your love, your everlasting love, has drawn us. Your love, your compassion, your mercy, and your grace is found in your presence. We pray, dear Lord, that we will experience once again your love and your mercy, and that you'll pour out your Holy Spirit so that our lives, our hearts are changed and transformed so that we can take on the very nature and character of Jesus Christ, our Savior. Father God, at this time, be awesome and wonderful yet again and speak to us as sinful human beings. Amen. Amen. Well, I know that Adventists do not eat lobsters. Good Adventists don't eat lobsters. But when you're catching a lobster, it's a fairly simple thing. You need a fairly large, sturdy cage. You put some bait in the cage, you lower it into the sea, you leave it there, lobsters come in, can't find their way out, you pull up the cage, and you have lobsters. It's a way somebody can earn a living. Lobster fishing. It's not a huge industry, but it's a substantial industry, and you don't need a huge crew to do it. It can be done by you yourself. Just get a fishing boat, the right equipment, buy a few lobster cages, and away you go, away you go. Good Adventists don't eat lobsters, though. We don't, do we? No, we don't. Shante read a scripture reading from Judges chapter 2 about a generation of people who grew up not knowing God. Serious. But let's turn in our Bible to Luke chapter 22 so we can start to find out why this generation grew up not knowing God. Luke chapter 22, towards the end of Jesus' life, he's trying to encourage and fortify his disciples for what lies ahead, his crucifixion, the shattering of their dreams and expectations, and eventually his resurrection. But they have to go through that Gethsemane and experience first. So he says to Simon in verse 31, Luke chapter 22, verse 31, he says this, "Simon, Simon, listen, Satan has commanded to sift you all, to sift all of you like wheat, but I have prayed for you that your own faith may not fail, and you, when once you have turned back, strengthen your brethren," strengthen your brothers. Satan, these are the words of Jesus Christ, "has desired to sift you as wheat." Satan looked on Simon Peter and says, "I need to sift his life as wheat." Why? Why? Because Satan realized that Peter had potential. Peter was a fiery, feisty sort of person. He was a person who was really emotional and passionate. He was a person who once fired up and directed it and pointed in the right direction, could do enormous and incredible things for God. Satan saw that in Peter. And Satan realized that if Peter was let loose with the power of God, Peter could do incredible things. Peter would even start to tear down Satan's kingdom. So Satan says, "I need to sift Peter's life as wheat. I need to get into every aspect of his life." As it says here, to sift all of you. Not just your spiritual aspect, but I'll go into your work life. I'll go into your marital life. I'll go and mess with your kids. I'll touch anything and everything in order to mess up your life. And once distracted, you'll be less effective for God. Satan had a plan for Peter. Satan had a plan to mess up Peter's life, to pull him back from his potential. Now, we know the plans of God, don't we? God has great plans. Jeremiah chapter 29, verse 11 says, "For I know the plans I have for you, saith the Lord. Plans to prosper you and not to harm. Plans to give you hope and a future." So God has great plans for you, and we can do great things. But Satan also has plans. Satan does not want anyone to succeed spiritually, because he cherishes his kingdom. And he would rather have you live a less than ordinary life and go to church but be ineffective. Whereas God desires for you to be tremendous, to be dynamic, to be full of energy, to achieve great things in and through him. The two contrasting plans, the plan of God and the plan of the devil. One's to sift you like wheat, the others to give you hope and a future. Jesus saw this and prayed for Simon. "I have prayed for you that your faith fails not, and when you have returned, strengthen your brethren." The plans of God against the plan of the devil. We have our young people who we love and cherish. And given the choice many of us as adults would die for our children. We love them that much, don't we, church? Yes, we love them that much. Many of us, given the choice, would die for our children. That's how much we love them. The bad news is, Satan has plans for our children. Satan wants to take our children's life and sift them as wheat. He does not want our children to reach or achieve their God-given potential. He does not want our children to excel spiritually and to do incredible things for God. He does not want our children to rise up as soldiers and warriors in God's army. He does not want our children to start to tear down his kingdom. And so he desires to sift them as wheat. There's many ways the devil can sift our children as wheat. Yes, there's the usual sex, drugs, and rock and roll. Throw in a little bit of tobacco as well, and drugs. But I want to think about, and I want us to focus on, one particular way the devil wants to sift our children as wheat and not allow them to reach their potential. And that's found in our scripture reading in Judges chapter 2. In verse 10, where it says this, "Moreover, that whole generation was gathered to their ancestors." This was a generation that plodded along through the wilderness for 40 years. This was a generation, and some of them were very young at the time, who could still remember life as slaves back in Egypt. This was a generation that was fed by God with manna on a daily basis. This was a generation who experienced their clothes never wearing out or their shoes never wearing out. This was a generation that saw water gush out from a rock. This was a generation who went up against armies far bigger than themselves and defeated them, who saw hailstones fall down on the enemy. This was that generation who saw the awesome wonders of God. That whole generation died out. That whole generation who experienced the power of God. And a new generation grew up who did not know God. A whole new generation grew up who did not know God. In other words, who did not have that relationship with God. Who did not know how to connect with God, who did not know how to hear the voice of God and to experience his power, who did not know how to pray and feel that their prayers are being heard and that God can communicate directly with them. He did not know all of this. This generation grew up not knowing the fundamentals of a relationship with God. And as a result, they worshiped other gods. And as a result, they went after the Baals and the Asherahs. As a result of not having this relationship with God. How can a whole generation grow up not knowing God? A whole generation. How can this be? Because the senior generation failed to teach them how to connect with God. The senior generation, the ones that experienced all the miracles, spoke about it, sang about it, but failed to teach them that it's more than just the songs, it's more than just the story. It's a relationship. They fail to show them that a relationship with God isn't just about the do's and the don'ts. It goes deeper than that. It's about you connecting with God on a one-to-one level. This whole generation failed to teach their young ones how to pray and to feel that God is listening and to know that God answers. This whole generation failed to teach them the fundamentals. This was a plan of the devil. He said, you know what? How can I stop them from achieving their potential? How can I drag them away from God? How can I mess up their future so that they cannot do what God wants them to do? I'll stop them connecting with God. I'll stop them having this relationship with God. I'll stop them hearing the voice of God. I'll stop them knowing God. In the UK, I was associate youth director over there as well. And one of the things I noticed as I went from church to church, from area to area, was that there was hundreds, nay thousands of young people who did not know God. Yes, they knew about Adventism. They knew about the commandments. They even had some sort of idea about our doctrines and beliefs. But they did not know God. And there's a huge difference between knowing Adventism, knowing what we stand for, knowing our traditions, and knowing everything that makes us who we are. There's a big difference between that and knowing God. This whole generation in the UK were growing up knowing about these things, Adventism, but not knowing God himself. They weren't having a relationship with him. And when I ask these young people, how often do you pray? How often do you spend time in Bible study per week? I'll be very lucky if they said once a week. Very lucky. They were not connecting with God. So when I was looking at the church and wondering why 60% of our young people leave the church, in my opinion, it's simply because they do not know God. They know Adventism, but they do not know God. 60% leave in the church because they realize, you know, how come I'm going to a church of a God who I really have no feelings for, who I'm really not connecting with? Why am I going every single Sabbath, sacrificing my time when I'm not really even sure he exists? I like the social aspect of church. I like the coming together. I like the youth groups. I like the days of fellowship. But on a one-on-one basis, I don't even know if I love him. I love my parents. I plan about my school and education. And, you know, I've got dreams about this and about that. But I do not know if God is a factor in it all. A whole generation growing up without knowing God. So what can we do about this? This whole new generation that's growing up without knowing God. What can we do? Because even though I've been here since April, for the time I've been here, I'm starting to see that the very same things that we were experiencing in the UK, very similar to what we're experiencing here. Young people growing up without knowing God. We teach them the doctrines. They know about the Sabbath and the health message, but they do not know God. So what can we do about it? What can we do about it? So there's this lobster fisherman called Doug Goodall from Maine, not far from here. And he has a boat and he goes out by himself every single day. and he has this wench that picks up these cages, these lobster cages, swings them over the side of the boat and lowers them into the sea. He has a boy that's attached to the end of the cage, and he knows where these cages are, and he leaves them there. He goes back the next day, picks them up, pulls out the lobster, lowers them back. And he has a fairly good living, enough to support his wife and his two girls. On this particular day, Doug Goodall's out at sea, pulling up the cages with his wench, when his hand gets caught in the wench. It pulls Doug Goodall up, mangling his hand all the way up to his elbow. And he's lifted high, and automatically the wench swings him out over the side of the boat. So here's Doug hanging by his right arm, his arms all mangled up to the elbow, caught in the wrench, swinging, bleeding to death. Now, if he stays like that, he will definitely die. It won't take him long. He'll definitely die. He has to make choices. Doug Goodall puts his left hand in his pocket, pulls out a knife, and cuts through his elbow joint. Cuts all the way through his elbow joint so that he can drop back into the boat and steer back to shore with his left hand. He decided that it was better to lose my right arm and live than to keep my right arm and die. It is better for me to make that sacrifice. What can we do? We can start making the hard choices. The hard choices that our young people need. We need to start to sacrifice. To sacrifice. To sacrifice. To distinguish between what is important, because an arm is important. You know, it's nice to have two arms. To distinguish between what is important and what is essential. What is essential? There are some things which are important in life, like your education, like the things around your home. And there's those things which are essential. And as far as I see it, the only essential thing is your eternal salvation. The only essential thing, when you weigh it all up and you think about it deeply, the only essential thing is your eternal salvation. And the agonizing thought that, what if I get to heaven and my children don't? What if I get to heaven and my children aren't there? How would I feel if I'm walking the streets of gold, but because I refuse to sacrifice, my children aren't there? Because I refuse to make the hard decisions now, my children aren't there. How would I feel? How will you feel? Making those tough decisions. Those decisions which sometimes even upset our kids to begin with. You know how it is. Some of the best things for our kids, they don't even like. How many of your kids love their vegetables? Oh, please, more on my plate. I have some more. Is there seconds of broccoli? But it's essential. It's very, very important for them to have it. And as a parent, as a good parent, you realize, you know what? You will eat your vegetables even though you do not like it. You get tough with your kids. You say, it's important for your well-being, your physical well-being, for you to have your vegetables. You will eat your vegetables. You will not eat so many sweets. You will eat your fruits. You'll drink plenty of water. You'll get exercise. You are firm with your kids. We are firm with our kids when it comes to our education. You will go to school. I know you don't feel it. You're saying, oh, I'm not too well today. No, you will go to school. And you will do your homework. We know how to be tough then. We need to be equally tough when it comes to our spiritual life. Equally tough. We need to see it as essential that we have family worship. We need to see it as essential that we have family worship. Deuteronomy chapter 6. Turn with me there. Deuteronomy chapter 6. Verse 4. Hear, O Israel, the Lord is our God, the Lord alone. You shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, and with all your soul, and with all your might. Keep these words that I am commanding you today in your heart. Recite them to your children, and talk about them when you are at home, and when you are away, and when you lie down, and when you rise. Bind them as a sign on your hand, fix them as an emblem on your forehead, and write them on the doorposts of your house and on your gate. Talk about these things. Talk to your children. Discuss with them. Teach them how to have a relationship with God. If, you know, in order for us to teach our children how to have a relationship with God, we first must have a relationship with God. It's pointless trying to teach something we know nothing about. We need to connect with God first. We need to be able to hear the voice of God. We need to know how God speaks. You know, people find it amazing when I say, God spoke to me the other day. God spoke to you? How did God spoke to me? Yeah. For example, I don't eat cheese. The reason why I don't eat cheese is because it affects my hay fever. I have allergies, and if I do not eat cheese, my hay fever is under control. I do not have to take any medication. And people say, how do you know that? Well, God told me, I said. I said, how did God tell you? Well, I told them the story. Well, I was one particular Sabbath, I was sat in my car, couldn't come out of my car because of my allergies. I was sneezing, my eyes were running and red and puffy. And I prayed, I said, Lord, help me get over these allergies. And God spoke to me. God spoke to you? Yes, God spoke to me, told me, give up cheese. And I listened, and a week later, all my signs and symptoms went. But God speaks to us. God speaks to us. You're not crazy if you hear the voice of God. I know that in our mental institutions, there are quite a few people who hear the voice of God. I'm not talking about that voice of God. I'm talking about the real voice of God, the voice of God that directs you into good. You need to be able to connect with God yourself. In order for you to teach other people, in order for you to teach your children, you first must have a relationship with God. So you first must have morning worship by yourself. You first must have morning worship as a couple and then as a family. You need to make time in your weekly schedule for you to connect with God, for you as a couple to connect with God, and for you as a family to connect with God. And this time of connection isn't just about going through the Sabbath school lesson study. It's about teaching your children how to have a relationship with God, how to pray, how to study the Bible, how to fast. We still fast as Adventists, don't we? Yes, we do. We fast, we meditate, and how to witness. Because in doing these disciplines, we ourselves will see the wondrous power of God. We will experience God speaking and working through us. And when we experience God, it'll be a lot easier for us to share him with our children. It's more than a theory, it's become reality in our lives. It's more than head knowledge, it's become a way of life. So sacrifices need to be made. Sacrifices need to be made. Perhaps we need to turn off our television a little bit more often. You know, I would go the whole nine yards and say, throw it out. But you know how they kind of grabbed Jesus one day and brought him to the hill, the crest of a hill, and was going to throw him off? I don't want that to happen to me. But we can turn off our television a lot more often. We can even start to schedule in some family worship into our weekly schedule. We can spend time, say, this time is dedicated to God, and not just the Sabbath. Sometimes at Seventh-day Adventists, we really become Seventh-day Adventists, and everything's sort of crammed into the Sabbath, and we try to get all our spiritual reality sorted out within these 24 hours. No, we can spread it out during the week. I was asking some of our young people about their experiences of family worship. And about 90% of them did not have family worship. 90%. I would ask for a show of hands now, but I would hate to see that here. In order for us to turn the devil's plans on his head, we need to make sacrifices, to make time for our children, to cut out those things which are eating up our time, like television, and to actively teach them how to know God. Jesus said to Simon, "Simon, Simon, the devil has desired to have you that he may sift you as wheat, but I have prayed for you." And when Jesus prays, he's saying, "I have given you the strength to do it. I'm giving you the strength to overcome. I have given you the strength to resist temptation and to do what you know you should do. I have prayed for you." And in the same way, if we're going to transform the lives of our young people, Jesus Christ is still interceding for us. He's still praying for us. He's praying for you and your family. And it's because he's praying for you and your family, he's giving you the strength and the opportunity to make those changes. We know the changes are hard. We know they're difficult, but Jesus Christ is giving you the strength and the opportunity to make those changes. You can transform your family. You can turn it around. You can bring about the best in your children. He is praying for you that you can do it. And you know what else he says? He said, "Also, Peter, when you return, strengthen your brethren." That means what one family has learned and what one family has gone through to overcome can be shared with another family. And with those two families, what they go through and how they overcome can be shared with another family. And the goodness and the transformation and the power of God can be moved through this whole church, through this whole community. The reforms made in your family can be shared. You can encourage, you can strengthen your brethren. It's not just you by yourself. There's other people who want the very same thing. Jesus said to Simon, "Simon, Simon, the devil has desired to have you so that he may sift you as wheat. But I pray for you that your faith fails not. And when you have returned, strengthen your brethren." This was just before Peter denied the Lord. You know, the whole cock crows three times. all of that. Jesus was warning Peter ahead of time. And ahead of time, God wants us to know that there is a time coming where people will not tolerate the word of God. There is a time coming when people will scorn the word of God. And we are virtually at that time now, where it's difficult even to approach somebody on the street and say, let me share the word of God with you, because they do not tolerate, they do not put up with it. Even within our own families, you know that there's maybe brothers and sisters in your family who are not Adventists. And sometimes it's very difficult to share with them the word of God. Jesus is warning us ahead of time that if we make these changes now, we can be prepared for the end times. If we make these changes now, we can fortify and strengthen our children to be able to go through the time of trouble. We can fortify and strengthen our children to be ready to go through the most difficult time the world has ever seen. You know, sometimes we pray about Jesus Christ coming. We say, Lord, come, come, come. And secretly in our heart we're saying, yes, but not while I'm alive. Not while I'm alive. But it could well come during our children's lifetime. And have we prepared them adequately? Jesus Christ was preparing Peter for a very, very difficult time. A time when he would deny his own Lord three times and then run away crying as a baby. Jesus was preparing him for that and saying, look, you know what, Peter? Even though you're going to go through this, I'm going to forgive you, you're going to return, and you will strengthen your brethren. We are going to go through a very difficult time as a church, the end times, the time we talk about, the time just before the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ. Are we ready? Let us do those things. Let us make those sacrifices that will enable us and our family and our children to make it through. Amen.
Thank you. Let us pray. Our Father God, we want to thank you, dear Lord, for the opportunity to hear a word from you, to worship you, and to come before you as your people. And as we leave this place, as we leave your sanctuary, we pray, dear Lord, that your Holy Spirit will continue to abide with us. May your awesome love and wonder work through our lives, transforming the lives of other people. We open up our hearts and minds and all our resources to be used by you as your people. So, Father God, strengthen us to be an example, to live the life, to share the love, and to make the difference in this world by making the difference in our families. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. Thank you.